Serbian police have reportedly captured the suspect in the second mass shooting to rock the Balkan nation in 2 days. The 21-year-old gunman killed 8 people and wounded 14 others in a drive-by attack in the village of Dubona. More than 600 members of Serbian special forces were deployed to search for the suspect. Now, this comes a day after a 13-year-old boy opened fire on his classmates at a school in the capital, Belgrade. At least 8 children and a security guard were killed in that attack. Because of his age, the boy cannot be criminally prosecuted under Serbian law, but will be placed in a psychiatric institution. The Serbian government now introducing a set of measures to prevent potential violence in schools. This includes halting the issuance of licenses to weapons holders. It has also tasked the Justice Ministry to lower the age for criminal punishment from 14 to 12 and organize groups of experts to counter peer violence in schools. In Pakistan, gunmen stormed a school in the northwest, killing several teachers. Authorities said 7 teachers were killed. They were all members of Pakistan's minority Shia community, which is frequently targeted by fighters as part of the local Taliban movement. Another teacher was gunned down in a separate attack. No group has claimed responsibility, but the regional commissioner said sectarian antagonism appeared to be the motive behind the shooting. Rwanda grieves the loss of loved ones and homes after heavy rains triggered devastating floods and landslides across the country. One village held a mass burial Thursday, mourning the death of 13 flood victims within their community. The torrential rains that started Tuesday hit Rwanda's western and northern provinces. Authorities have since recorded 130 deaths, with dozens injured and 5 reported missing. They also noted that over 5,000 homes were completely destroyed, while a further 2,500 sustained varying damage. 4 members of the far-right Proud Boys militia group have been found guilty for their roles in planning and leading the violent January 6 U.S. Capitol attack. A jury in Washington, D.C. delivered the guilty verdict Thursday against Enrique Tarrio, the group's longtime chairman, Ethan Nordine, Joseph Biggs, and Zachary Rell. The charge can carry up to 20 years in prison. They also face a host of other charges, including obstructing an official proceeding, which can also carry 20 years in prison. More than 100 members of the all-male group joined the Capitol riot in 2021, where supporters of former President Donald Trump stormed Congress in a bid to thwart the certification of Joe Biden's election victory. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says granting the U.S. access to military bases in the Philippines is a defensive step that could prove useful if China attacks Taiwan. Marcos explains the 2014 Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement was originally conceived to improve disaster response in the Philippines. But given the situation in Taiwan, Marcos says there's now a new aspect to that deal.
Whilst the tensions across the Taiwan Straits seem to be continuing to increase, then the safety of our Filipino nationals in Taiwan becomes of primordial importance. And so that these EDCA sites will also prove to be useful for us should that terrible occurrence come about.
Marcos insists, though, Washington is not asking Manila to help defend Taiwan should tensions with China escalate.
The U.S. has not proposed any kind of action for the Philippines in terms of taking part in the defense of Taiwan or in the, any other affirmative action that the United States might feel they need to take. As I said, it's a defensive. It is of a defensive nature, and it is of a civil defense nature. When I talk about the disasters and I talk about the evacuation of our Filipino nationals.
Marcos came to the U.S. seeking clarity on the extent of Washington's commitment to protect the Philippines. His trip was the first White House visit by a Philippine leader in 10 years, marking a sharp change in tone from the Duterte administration, which sought closer ties with China. President Marcos, meanwhile, says joint patrols in the South China Sea could begin this year. The countries included in the joint patrols are the U.S., Australia, Japan, and South Korea. Marcos says the move is meant to preserve the freedom of navigation in the South China Sea and not to provoke Beijing.
The nuts and bolts of that are still being worked out right now. But essentially, the purpose of all of these actions is to preserve the freedom of navigation in the South China Sea for the simple reason that a great deal of trade goes through that that part of the world. And it does not affect only Asia or ASEAN or China, but it affects the rest of the world as well. What we worry about, because I am convinced, for one, that no one, not anyone, not the United States, not China, not Asia, not any of the member states, none of them, none of us, are interested in going to war. However, what we worry about are mistakes, misjudgments, misunderstandings that might cause an escalation and a heightening of tensions in the area.
The Philippine government has been urged to conduct joint sea patrols with its allies in a bid to enforce Manila's landmark arbitral victory and deter China's aggressive behavior. Beijing, meanwhile, says it opposes any move to meddle in the South China Sea issue. The Chinese Foreign Ministry stresses the South China Sea is a shared home for countries in the region and not a hunting ground for outside forces.
China firmly opposes any country using the bilateral treaty as an excuse to intervene in the South China Sea issue and damage China's territorial sovereignty and maritime rights and interests. The key to peace and stability in the South China Sea is that countries in the region adhere to mutual trust, solidarity, and cooperation and take the initiative to properly handle differences in their own hands.
But President Marcos says he does not feel alluded to in China's latest remark.
How can anyone say that we are not a party in interest in all of these issues? So I think that kind of statement was directed more towards the United States than it was for the Philippines. I think the Philippines' actions are in continuing to strengthen our capabilities, to continue to find and forge partnerships with the United States and both in the governmental sector and also with the private corporations that we have spoken to as an important part of what we have been trying to develop in the past almost 1 year. And that is I think only right and proper because we in the Philippines need to do this if we are going to go forward and find new opportunities for our people. At hindi naman masasabi na walang karapatan ng Pilipinas na gawin lahat yun. Kaya yung statement na yan, sa palagay ko hindi nakadirect sa Pilipinas.
After his visit to the U.S., President Marcos is off to Britain to witness King Charles III's coronation on May 6th. He's expected to arrive in London this afternoon, Manila time.
Isa sa pinakamalaking dahilan kung bakit ako pupunta ay kilala namin si Prince Charles pa ang pagkakilala ko sa kanya. At kaming lahat ay namatay nga ang si Queen Elizabeth ay hindi ako nakapunta at ang pinadala ko si ang kapatid ko na si Irene, nakilalang kilala rin ni Prince Charles. Kaya sabi ko naman ay palagay ko dahil magkakilala kami, dapat naman napakalaking bagay na siya'y kukoronahan bilang hari ng United Kingdom, ay dapat makapag-attend na ako.
Marcos, meanwhile, says he plans to have a casual meeting with British Prime Minister Rishi Sunak on the sidelines of the coronation. He adds his schedule in the UK is very tight, leaving no window for a sit-down meeting with other world leaders.
So very casual lang ito, very informal. Pero wag natin mamaliitin yung mga ganyang klaseng meeting dahil kuminsan, yung hindi mo inaakalaing mangyayari, may nangyayari na napaka-importante pala. Makikipagkita ako sa kanilang bagong Prime Minister, Prime Minister Sunak, upang makapag-usap kami kung meron bang pagbabago sa kanyang pag-iisip sa pagpartner ng UK at saka ng Pilipinas. Sa palagay ko ay ganun din ang sasabihin niya na dapat ipapatibayin natin at naghihingalo, hirap na hirap ang ekonomiya ng UK. So baka isang bagay yun na pag-uusapan namin kung paano mag-trade o kung paano dagdagan, isa sa lahat, I'm sure, babanggitin niya kung pwedeng makakuha ng healthcare workers galing Pilipinas, dadalhin sa UK. In general, we will maintain the same relationship. It has been a very a relationship very advantageous to all parties involved. So I think that we will stay the course. And